oddly, the American workplace is the one place where we should be having more of these conversations, but ironically, it's the one place where we're least likely to do it.
If you are a manager, if you're a people leader, if you're an executive, really it's up to you. You know, your employees are looking to you to create an environment where they can thrive.
Hello, everyone. I'm Matthew Harrison, Vice President of Human Resources for Jackson Healthcare, where I also lead our diversity and inclusion initiatives. I'm thrilled to have with me today Dara Okeke, who's president of Epic Consulting, and she's also an employment attorney. It's an organization that partners with forward-thinking companies that are really committed to doing work around the diversity, equity, and inclusion space. These are companies that are really looking to create work environments where their employees are able to bring their fullest selves into the workplace each and every day.
Absolutely.
So again, Dara, honored to have you with
Thank
us today.
You.
So
it's
happy
my
to be
honor.
Doing this with you. So we want to start really just talking about kind of the foundation of kind of race in America, how it started and how it's kind of related and become a part of the workplace. I know it's going to be a little heavy and deep with this first one,
but where
should we start?
I think we should begin with everyone's favorite topic. Slavery.
So much fun. So much fun.
It's literally no one's favorite topic.
No one.
But I do think it's a really important place for us to start. If you're a history buff, if you're into, you know, documentary films, if you're into historical fiction, you understand that, you know, in order for us not to repeat our past, we need to know our history.
Absolutely.
And so I think when we're talking about race in the workplace and what it looks like today, it's really important to understand the foundations of race in the workplace. And that starts with African slaves being brought to America for forced labor many centuries ago. That really was America's first race-based economic system.
Yep.
You know, we call it systemic oppression, systemic discrimination. We call it that for a reason, because it really was a system. Slavery in America was not only an economic practice, but it affected so many different facets of American life. And I think the vestiges of slavery, the attitudes, the philosophies about people and their worth still live on today, and even in the American workplace. So I think that's where we really need to begin, is acknowledging that, you know, this was a horrible stain on American history, but it absolutely happened and shouldn't be minimized. You know, back in those times, you know, an average of 30% of white families owned slaves. And in some states, that number was even higher, in the 50% range. And so, you know, this was something that was widespread. And that really did affect families on a day-to-day basis. The attitudes about, you know, black people and their intelligence or lack thereof, you know, whether they were meant to lead or to be subservient, those attitudes really originated with this construct of race and with this slavery system. And so, you know, even though slavery did eventually end around the 1860s, you know, we moved into a new era where there was still the systemic oppression that existed. You know, it would have been wonderful if, you know, slavery ended, we're all emancipated and we're all
utopian
equal,
society.
You know, like, yay. But unfortunately, it didn't happen that way.
Yeah.
What happened is that, you know, instead of, you know, being a slave, you might have become free, but you were then a sharecropper. And so you had very little resources, very little money. There weren't huge grants that were being given to freed slaves. There was no advanced education that was provided for free to kind of help bridge that gap and to level the playing field. And so you have this kind of permanently subservient class now moving forward into the modern American world. You know, we entered the Jim Crow era of separate but equal, and of segregation, where, you know, the idea was, okay, well, black people are free. You're no longer owned or considered chattel or someone's property, but you stay over there and we'll do our thing over here. And there is this idea that can somehow be equal, but it can't, you know, without, you know, true unity and togetherness. How could we have equal resources and equal opportunities? So I feel like we've kind of slowly moved over the centuries. We've slowly evolved. Mm-hmm. And I think we're certainly moving in the right direction, but we must remember that we still hold on to some of those attitudes and some of those feelings and perspectives on people and who they are and their value from that really difficult time when slavery existed in America.
Yep, absolutely. And some people argue, though, you know, slavery was 400 years ago. Jim Crow was, you know, a long time ago as well. So are these things still prevalent? And if so, how and why?
Yeah, people do argue that. But if you look at the timeline, it really hasn't been that long since slavery ended. You know, we're talking about approximately 150 years max, mm-hmm. That we've been, you know, quote unquote free. But we still see in today's world remembrance of that time. Mm-hmm. And we see it in our economy. We see it in the wage gap between Black people and their counterparts at work. We see it in the prison system. Mm-hmm. We see it in the education system and the way that our Black and brown children aren't receiving the same type and quality of education as their white counterparts. It's truly systemic in that it impacts the whole and not just the parts. I think we are still seeing the effects of that time today. And, you know, if you even look around what's happening in the world and, you know, the many uprisings related to police-involved shootings and killings of unarmed Black people, we are seeing people still trying to contend with this idea that, yes, we're all free, yes, we all should be equal, mm-hmm. But we're still not treated that way. And so I think until we are brave enough and bold enough to address these issues head-on, to address bias head on and really have honest and difficult conversations about it, there's no way that we can move forward.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. I mean, I think about my own parents. My father went to a segregated high school. My mom was part of the class that integrated her high school. I mean, and my parents are in their mid 60s and early 70s. And so, you know, worked in, you know, the American workforce. My mom is actually still working, hasn't retired yet. And so I do think sometimes people often forget that a lot of these things, particularly when thinking about kind of the civil rights movement and the segregation, really wasn't that long ago. Yeah. And we have a lot of people still working today that were around during those times. Mm-hmm. So thinking about it in terms of kind of, again, the foundation of America and race and all of that, how then does that tie into how we as employees, managers, and leaders can be better at making our corporate spaces more inclusive and equitable?
Yeah, I mean, I think first there has to be an acknowledgement of difference. You know, I often would hear when I first started doing diversity work, oh, well, you know, I don't need this diversity training because I'm colorblind and I don't see color and I don't see race. And that sounds so nice.
It does.
But it is a fallacy. Mm-hmm. You know, unless you actually have the medical diagnosis of colorblindness, you are not colorblind.
Yeah.
You see me.
Yeah.
I am a beautiful Black woman sitting in front of you. You see my color. You see my locks. You see who I am.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not a bad thing.
Exactly.
And I think for so long, people have felt so uncomfortable acknowledging difference and speaking about it. And that's the problem. You know, the problem is that we're afraid to talk, we're afraid to really connect with each other in a meaningful way, and afraid to acknowledge that the past was really hard for a lot of us.
Yeah.
And we're still suffering the effects of that. And I think the sooner that corporate leaders can build up that confidence and that bravery to acknowledge that, you know, we've got some work to do,
mm-hmm.
When it comes to representation, when it comes to pay equity, when it comes to development and promotion of women and Black and brown people, when it comes to retention.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's some serious work to do that's not surface level.
Mm-hmm.
It's deeply rooted in implicit biases, mm-hmm. also some explicit biases, mm-hmm. and prejudice, mm-hmm. but deeply rooted in our own blind spots and those things that we haven't taken the time to really recognize in ourselves and acknowledge as systemic.
Yeah.
And so I think once our corporate leaders can get comfortable with being uncomfortable,
yeah.
that's when you'll see the true change begin.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. I've always felt working in human resources that oddly, the American workplace is the one place where we should be having more of these conversations, but ironically, it's the one place where we're least likely to do
it. It's taboo.
Yeah,
it's considered
exactly.
inappropriate,
yeah.
you know?
Yep.
Like, you don't talk about that at work or with your colleagues,
yep.
but how do we ever transform ourselves? How do we ever grow and evolve to be the workplaces where everyone wants to come? And like you said earlier, you know, where everyone feels like they belong.
Yeah.
I think it starts with that really difficult work up front.
Yeah, yeah, and I agree. You know, I feel like because if many of us are being honest with ourselves, most of our friends and families are gonna be units of folks who look very similar to mm-hmm. us. And so because of that, our feelings around race and privilege and things like that are likely not gonna be challenged because those people have probably had very similar life experiences that we've had.
Exactly.
And again, I think the workplace, again, we come into contact with people who are different and who have therefore had those different experiences. And that gives us the prime opportunity to hear those different perspectives. And again, maybe not necessarily have our minds changed,
right.
but at least have our perspectives broadened.
Exactly.
And you know, working in human resources, and I know with you being an employment attorney, we get why sometimes people may shy away from the
yeah,
conversation.
You know,
we get it.
You do have to be careful
yep.
and proceed with caution, but that doesn't mean don't do it.
Yep.
You know, you have to be, like I said, you have to be brave, you have to be thoughtful,
mm-hmm.
And understand that this is a delicate space for a lot of people, and it's very new for people to talk about race at work.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, if you are a manager, if you're a people leader, if you're an executive, really, it's up to you. You know, mm-hmm. your employees are looking to you to create an environment where they can thrive. And so you have to educate yourself. You have to develop some personal comfort with broaching these topics.
Mm-hmm.
If you need to practice in the mirror, you know, like whatever it takes for you to get more comfortable, create some talking points for yourselves, but have the conversation.
Got it. And I know, you know, we think about with our audience that's listening to us, they're busy executives, they're busy leaders. So this topic around diversity and inclusion, though incredibly important, can be like yet another thing that they're required to do and have to do.
Yes.
And so I love what you've done in terms of kind of breaking it down into some easy things that our viewers should do. And you've kind of packaged it, and I love it this way of things that they should study, things that they should see, and things that they should share.
Yes, study, see, share.
Love it. So as it pertains to this particular topic around kind of the history of race and race America, what are some things our folks listening should study, see, and share?
So for study, see, and share, for this particular topic, I would recommend the book, Why Are All of the Black Kids Sitting in the Cafeteria Together? Did I get that right?
Why Are All the Black Kids Sitting Together in the Cafeteria?
You're close. Okay. you know, I read this book a very long time ago, and it was very poignant for me. Really spoke to me and spoke to kind of what I experienced growing up. I think it would provide really good insight for business leaders to get a better understanding of bias and mm-hmm. how, you know, we're not only segregated by others, but sometimes we self-segregate because
yep.
we don't feel comfortable and we don't feel welcomed. So I think that would be a really great study.
Mm-hmm.
I also, in terms of C, I would recommend 12 Years a Slave,
mm-hmm.
which is a very powerful movie about a freed black man who was actually re-enslaved.
Right. Yeah.
The horror.
Yeah.
Could you imagine?
Yeah. Yeah.
And then for Share, this is really about broadening your own personal horizons, stepping a little bit outside of your comfort zone, and doing something proactive to really, for your own edification and your own personal growth. So for Share, I would recommend that you, our listeners, find someone who grew up in, you know, the 60s, in, you know, the South, the American South, during the Civil Rights Movement, or, you know, during segregation. Is it someone who attended a segregated school? Did they have to use separate facilities from, you know, mm-hmm. people of another race? And just ask them about that experience. You know, what was that like for you? You know, how did it feel to know that, you know, one water fountain was for you and that other people had to use a totally separate facility?
Mm-hmm.
Just dig deep and you know, really try to figure out like what that experience was like and what they took away from it. You know, I wonder, you know, what ideas people have today and what feelings they have today about race that may have been impacted by their experience growing up at that time. So that's the share for this time, is to have a really deep and meaningful conversation with someone who was growing up during that time, and see what you take away from it.
Well, I think those are great. And that's it for this segment. So audience, thank you for tuning in with us. We have a few more segments that we're gonna be doing with you. One where we're gonna be talking about biases and blind spots, and another for do's and don'ts in corporate America. Thank you for joining us, and thank you again, Dara.
Thank you.